Its orbit is a few dozen days, and that means that it is relatively cool. And so we think this is a really nice candidate for doing not just the original detection work to figure out how big it is and how much it weighs, but also to do atmospheric characterization.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jessie Christiansen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets. So today, I am super excited to have good friend and excellent scientist with us, Dr. Jennifer Burt. She is an EPRV investigation scientist at JPL, and we're going to learn all about what that is. Jen, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm so excited.
So where are you physically right now?
I am in my home office in Altadena, which is just a bit north of the Pasadena area where I think you are.
That's right. And so when you're in your office, where's your office?
I work at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, or JPL, which is also in the Pasadena, Altadena area in Southern California.
Fantastic. Where are you now in your career?
So I came to JPL a few years ago as a postdoc, which is kind of the position you hold after you get your doctorate before you have a permanent position. And I did that for 2 years. And then about a year and a half ago now, I transferred to a staff scientist position.
Fantastic. How are you enjoying it so far?
It's been pretty good. It's nice to not have to do job applications every 3 years, which is the normal duration of a postdoc.
Yes. So for people who are listening, being a postdoc is fantastic, except for the fact that you're always looking for jobs.
Yes.
Lots so it's of great to be freedom. In the next stage. Yeah. Okay. So speaking of your career, at the start of your career, did you ever think that you would be finding exoplanets?
So when I was an undergrad, when I was doing my 4 years of college, I was studying planets in the solar system. I worked on understanding the dynamics of the rings around Saturn and had a really good time with that. And then when I applied to graduate school, it was like right as exoplanets were starting to show up, maybe not in textbooks yet, but at least in lectures given by my professors. And so I applied to grad school very specifically saying, I want to go find planets. Like my goal was to go somewhere that had telescope access and where I could find things.
Okay, so you had a dream. You were going to find exoplanets. I was similar, actually. So yeah, when I was an undergrad, exoplanets had just been starting to be found, and I wanted to find exoplanets.
Yeah.
Okay, so you go to grad school, you have telescope access, you know planets are out there.
Yeah.
Tell us how you discovered your first planet.
So yeah, my first one was a fun confluence of discovery, science discovery, and also kind of technology. So my thesis work was focused around helping to bring a new telescope online. It's called the Automated Planet Finder, or the APF. It's located at Lick Observatory, which is in San Jose, so in the northern part of California. And the goal of this telescope was to do planet detection all day, every day. I guess all night, every night is the better way to phrase that.
Right.
Because one of the things we really struggle with in the primary way that I find planets, which is the radial velocity method, is high cadence observation. So you need to look at stars over and over and over again, preferably every night or multiple times a night if you can swing it. That's very hard to do on big telescopes that have many instruments on them where people are trying to do many different kinds of science. Because then you're fighting with the people who want to study faint, fuzzy galaxies and the people who want to look at comets and all other sorts of, yeah, like great science. I love what they're doing. It gets in the way of, please let me look at these set of stars every night.
So before you go any further, tell us what radial velocity is.
Sure. So there are a couple ways to find planets. The one that I use, this radial velocity method, is focused on taking the light from a star and splitting it into a rainbow. So much like the way a sun catcher that you might hang in your kitchen window makes little rainbows on your wall. We're doing the same thing, but at a much higher resolution, higher precision level. And then we look at those rainbows from the stars and you'll see little black lines in them. Those are what we call absorption lines. They are caused by specific elements and molecules in the outer layer of the star that grab onto very specific colors of light and don't let go. And so you can use those lines to basically fingerprint the star and understand what types of elements and molecules are in its outer layers. But the thing that's really exciting is when you look at the star over and over again and you see those lines move back and forth over time. And that back and forth motion is an indicator that the star is being Doppler shifted. So it's moving back and forth away from us. And if you see that happen over and over again in a pattern, that can indicate the presence of a planet. And so you can use those motions, how big they are, how quickly they happen, to figure out how big your planet is and how far away it is from the star.
Okay, so during your PhD, you're designing a building and commissioning a new instrument that is designed to measure the radial velocities of many stars over and over again with the highest cadence you can. Do I have it right?
Yes, I should admit that this instrument already existed by the time I got there. So I've never actually like turned wrenches on the APF or its spectrograph. So that had all been done, but they had like just turned it on for the first time effectively when I got
that
involved.
That is such a great time to start as a grad student. Like someone built it, someone turned it on, you just get to go through the data.
Yeah, exactly. So I was in charge of observing. So the goal in the long term was for this thing to run itself. The A stands for automated. That takes some time and effort. And so in the interim, it was like, well, we'll have the grad student run it and that will be good.
I mean, as far as the professor's concerned, that's basically automated, right? If you just have a bunch of grad students doing it.
Yeah. And it turns out that a really good way to make sure your telescope gets automated is to put the person who is designing the automation in charge of the every night observing, because then they have a lot of motivation to get the automation up and running.
The incentive is high to reduce your own workload.
Yes. But yeah, so I get to Santa Cruz. I start working on this telescope. We are doing a lot of, you know, human observing as we work towards automation, which now it is automated. It runs beautifully. It's great.
Hey.
But yeah. And so a lot of the early science cases were demonstrations that the telescope was working right as well. And so the very first planet that my name is on as the first author is Gliese 687b.
Ooh.
And yeah. And so this is a system where the star had previously been looked at by my advisors in years prior using the high-res spectrograph on Keck. And they thought they saw, you know, signs of a planet there. But then we started observing it with the APF as well, because if you see the exact same signal with the same period and the same alignment in two different instruments, then that is excellent proof that this is, you know, a real signal coming from the star and not something that's coming from your spectrograph or your telescope.
Got it.
So we observed it with the APF for a while. The signal looked beautiful and confirmed everything that had started to emerge from the Keck data. And so called that good and wrote that up. And it's my very first author paper.
Hooray. Oh, that's a good way to start. Your first author paper. Bang. It's a planet.
Yep.
So how did you feel when you realized that it was really a planet and that you'd really be able to write it up?
It was great. The combination of like, this is a real science discovery and holy crap, the telescope is working and doing all the things we wanted it to do was like the best combination of feelings and successes that you could ask for at that early stage of a science career.
Wow. Yeah. And also you had your goal of like going to grad school and finding a planet, like that's a real threefer right there.
Yeah. The trifecta came in. It was like, oh man, we did it.
So I'll admit now that I went to grad school to find planets and I didn't find any. It was fine. They still gave me a PhD. So
you found many since then, I'm very confident in saying. So.
Yes, I have found many since then, but grad school, not so much. So speaking of finding many, how many have you discovered in total, Jen?
Ooh, so I think like first author papers that I led, I'm up to 6 at this point. If we include things where I'm a co-author and did like, you know, something useful to help the process along, probably a few dozen by now.
Okay. Yeah, that's pretty exciting. Six that you own that Jennifer Burt discovered and got to publish.
Yeah.
Very cool. All right. So of those, or any really, what's your favorite real planet?
I think, I'm going to choose one of mine because I feel like I've, you know, they're my precious babies. That should be where the favorites lie.
Exactly.
So the most recent one probably, which is called TOI 1231. And TOI means it is a TESS object of interest. So this is a planet that was first discovered by NASA's TESS mission, or the Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite. And so this is a planet
A lot of acronyms, sorry.
I know,
a lot of acronyms.
I'm so sorry. Welcome to science. We really like acronyms.
TOI is an acronym that has an acronym inside it.
Yeah, it's like a compound acronym. Why do we do this to people? It's terrible.
Because it's NASA.
Yeah, fair. So this was first discovered by TESS. It is a planet that passes in front of its star from our point of view here on Earth. And so that means that as the planet passes in front of the star, you can figure out how big the planet is. And so we had a sense of how big the planet was and how long it took to go around its star. And then we could identify, based on the information, that it was a really good candidate for doing radial velocity work to also then get the mass of the planet, which is the big thing that you get from radial velocities that you don't get from most other detection methods. And so we chased after this planet. And the reason it is particularly exciting is it is a relatively small planet. It's about the size of Neptune. And it is relatively far away from its star. So its orbit is a few dozen days, and that means that it is relatively cool. And so we think this is a really nice candidate for doing not just the original detection work to figure out how big it is and how much it weighs, but also to do atmospheric characterization.
Okay, so TOI 1231b, your favorite real planet. Tell us about your favorite fictional planet.
So there are so many good ones to choose from, and I struggled with this question over the past week. I'm more of a fantasy person than a sci-fi person when you think about like types of media that I like to, you know, engage with when I'm relaxing. And it turns out that fantasy books or movies don't often spend a ton of time on like the nuances of the planets. But a great exception to this, and one of my favorite authors, is Brandon Sanderson, who has written a bunch of fantasy novels and does a really nice job of actually thinking about like the science and the physics that goes into the worlds he creates. And so I picked Roshar, which is the planet that the Stormlight Archive novels are set in.
Fantastic. We are going to find out more about Roshar in the next segment of my chat with Jen. Please follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter to find out more about this favorite fictional planet and its real-world counterpart. Thanks so much, everyone.